place, okay?
To the flag of the United States of America and to the republic for which it stands, one nation, under God, indivisible, with liberty and justice for all.
Thank you so much. Veterans who are here, I want to thank you and all the veteran service organizations and other constituents who have taken time to be here today. Thank you very much. I look forward to a very fruitful and productive year. I'll let Senator Dow introduce his folks. And Senator Dow was the ranker on this committee. And, you know, I think it's important to just say right now, there may be a division in this state, but there's not a division on these issues. When it comes to our veterans, these are not partisan issues. When it comes to military affairs, people serve in the reserves or active duty, inactive, those are not partisan issues. And when it comes to homeland security, where we live in a state that is the largest terrorist target outside of Jerusalem, where we live in a state that is the largest terrorist target in the world outside of Jerusalem, we simply cannot be partisan issues. I take this committee extremely seriously, and I know that every chairman is going to say that. This is the most important committee in New York State, above and beyond. We've got to take it that way. And I ask that each and every member of this committee, regardless of which side of the aisle, that you reach out to me. Because unfortunately, the harsh reality in New York State, especially on homeland security, is that's not a question of if, it's a question of when. So let us all move forward to making sure that we have done absolutely everything we can within our power at the state level to protect our people, to take care of our veterans, and not military.
Sure. Well, thank you very much. And again, I do look forward to working with Jim Ball and all the colleagues here at this table is doing what we can for our veterans. And certainly, we take this opportunity to again echo the chairman's sentiment, saying thank you to our veterans and veterans for what they've done today, commitment and dedication to our country. You know, during these tough fiscal times, obviously, we need to do what we can to protect the current programs that are out there, you know, increase when we can the programs that are out there, and certainly do the policy changes that need to be done to benefit our veterans. So again, I look forward to working with Chairman Ball and this committee as we go forward in doing that. While I'll have this opportunity, let me introduce the Democratic members of this committee here today. We have Senator Avella, Senator Klein, Senator Savino here with me. And again, we look to, like Chairman Ball said, across party lines. You know, there are no boundaries when we talk about veterans issues here. Obviously, we need to work with everyone to get the job done. So I do look forward to doing that. And thank you for the opportunity.
And with us, we have Colonel Larkin, who is an amazing man and has chaired this committee in the past and brings an amazing amount of knowledge. And Senator, I'll be leaning on you every single day. And you know that. And please don't hold it against me that I am Air Force. Because,
you know, somebody's got to take you there. thank you very much, Mr. Chairman.
And Captain, right? Captain Senator Lee Zeldin, Senator Mark Grisanti, and Senator Crispin. So it's a pleasure to have you here today. And let's all work together, okay? Alrighty. Director Krause, the acting director, he couldn't be here today. He will be with us at a later point to present to this committee on the Veterans Affairs issue. So, in fact, we're going to try to get that done, Bob, by next committee, right?
Yes.
Okay, without further ado, we'll move right forward with the bills, if you don't mind. Any objections?
Good.
Okay. Our first bill is 878 by Senator Golden. Council will read.
Senate Bill 878 by Senator Golden, an act to amend the real property tax law in relation to an optional school tax exemption for certain disabled veterans. This bill would add a new section of 459 of the real property tax law to allow veterans with at least a 40% disability to obtain a school tax exemption. The school district must authorize this exemption by resolution, and medical proof of the disability would be required.
Are there any questions on that?
Thank you, Mr. Chair. First of all, I'm obviously in support of the bill. I actually, when I was a member of the New York City Council, introduced a resolution asking the state legislature to do something similar, actually not only for disabled but for all veterans. The question I have, and it's maybe it's not even a question, but to put something on the record,
sure.
The part of the bill that says local exemption, where the local school district has to vote on this. I guess when it comes to New York City, that would be the New York City Department of Education. What happens when, in this case, Mayor Bloomberg decides to tell the Department of Education not to do it? And the reason I raise that is because for the Cold War exemption, what the legislature passed, New York City decided not to opt into it. And I feel bad for the veterans of New York City that, you know, the state legislature passed that bill and they don't have the benefits of it.
And we have that issue in our community as well. Bob, do you have a... Well, traditionally, all tax exemption bills, whether for veterans or otherwise, have been done by local option. We certainly hope that the localities will take advantage of that. The Cold War veteran means one of the ones that was passed by this legislature in recent years on that. To force them to do that, however, becomes very problematic. And our strong recommendation is we will authorize that and hopefully that they can take advantage of it. Certainly, Senator, I know that you could lobby the city of New York to be able to...
I tried. On the cold water, I did try. And I will continue to do so, certainly, on this. But I think we should mention for the record that it's important that we do pass this, but that, especially in New York City, the mayor has opted not to go ahead. And I would be surprised he doesn't opt into this one.
There's a larger issue on that. Before I do that, I was remiss. You all know Bob Farley, who has extensive experience on this committee and he's the majority counsel. My chief of staff, Jim Coleman, and Krista Gott, my legislative director. So you'll get to know Krista and Jim very well. But, you know, the larger point, Senator, on this is that there are a lot. We've got to work with our veterans groups, with our veterans organizations, to fight for them at the local level once we've done our job. And the larger issue is that there are a lot of service, Senator. Andreas, how are you? Thank you for joining us. There are a lot of services out there that should be extended to veterans. There are a lot of programs out there. And as we move forward legislatively, we've got to realize there are a host of programs at the state and federal level that a lot of veterans don't even know about. And that's our job. We've got to work harder to let them know what services are available. Okay. May I have a motion to report?
Move it.
And a second.
Second.
Okay. All in favor?
Aye.
Any opposed? Okay. Let's go into finance. Next bill, my bill, S-2421. Council will read.
This bill would be an act to amend the military law and the election law in relation to counting the ballots of deceased military personnel. This bill would provide that any active duty service member who casts an absentee or military ballot shall have such ballot counted in the event that such service member dies in the line of action between the date of the election after the ballot was cast. Currently under present election law, that if a person casts a ballot and dies before the date of the election, that vote does not count. This would make an exception to that for someone who is killed as an active duty service member in the line of action.
Any questions on that?
Yeah, I have a couple of questions, Senator Wall. Thank you. I mean, I understand what you're trying to do here, but I have a couple of questions. One, have you talked to anybody at the Board of Elections about how they would implement this or what it would take to actually count these ballots? Because I actually talked to them, and their explanation is that unless a military ballot is that was segregated, at some point they will open those ballots, and they'll open other absentee ballots. What, of course, would that up or in the event that the election were close enough that the absentees and the militaries would potentially make a difference.
Yeah.
But at some point, they will open all of those ballots, and unless someone objects to it or they've already updated their records, which they get monthly death certificates, the likelihood is these ballots are probably already counted.
Mm-hmm.
So have they spoken to you about how they would create a new procedure to count these ballots separate from what they do right now?
Yeah. We have spoken to the Board of Elections. And the state board, as well as a number of local boards on this piece of legislation. Currently, they are obligated to go through and purge all the absentee or military ballots when they have the information that the individual has died between the date of the election and the time they cast the ballot. Do things fall through the cracks? I'm certain that they do. I mean, that's just life. What this would do is make that change in the law where they have to count it. Traditionally, that has been an anti-fraud procedure where you don't want people where to get voting in an election. But this is a special circumstance where someone was killed in the service of their nation, and there is no fraud here because the ballot was transported by the United States military through the post office here. This isn't a circumstance where there would be somebody else bringing it to the Board of Elections or the other fraud issues coming.
So they recognize that they're going to have to develop some sort of a process to deal with military ballots separate from what they do right now. In the event they're given information from the military about veterans who have voted that have since passed away since the date they filed. So
traditionally what occurs is the board would on its own purge that ballot. This would say that they don't. And if, in the event that one of the parties who, in a recount situation, had information on that, they couldn't have it purged pursuant to an objection.
Thank you.
Senator Carlucci.
It's actually going to make the process easier for the Board of Elections and not having to waste really time and having to go through the ballot process and all the military ballots, which is basically common.
Correct.
So.
It certainly sends a good, you know, a very good statement. Any other questions? All right. All in favor of reporting? Okay, can I get a second?
Second.
All in favor?
Aye. Aye.
Opposed? Okay, bill's reported to council. Next bill, 2422. Council will read.
This is an act to amend the executive and the military law in relation to the establishment of the New York State Veterans Health Insurance Act. Specifically, this bill would add a new section 368 to the executive law to provide members of the Air National Guard and Army National Guard who are eligible to enroll in the Federal TRICARE Reserve Select Health Insurance with any and all enrollment fees and cost-sharing co-payments necessary for such person to enroll in individual or family coverage under this program. What this bill would basically do is pick up the co-pay share of the soldier or airman for this federal health insurance program. The federal government pays for the vast majority, it's almost over 80% right now, of this program, and that the soldier or airman would be responsible for the remaining percentage. Because of the fact that the vast majority of these individuals are enrolled or have their families enrolled in Child Health Plus, this would actually be a revenue neutral bill because 80% of it is picked up by the federal government.
Yeah. Are there any questions on this?
You said soldier and airman.
Correct.
You are taking into consideration we have sailors.
This is only for Air National Guard and Army National Guard, Senator, because the other individuals on active duty in the Army, Navy, Air Force, Marine Corps are under a different insurance policy, and they already have it picked up.
One question, Bob. Why are the vast majority of their children enrolled in Plus,
generally,
Plus.
This is for line Air National Guard and Army National Guard. These statistics were provided to us by the Division of Naval and Military Affairs, or Military and Naval Affairs, I should say, on this, and it comes down to income issues, to be honest with you. And a vast majority of these individuals do not take it because the people who are paying for this currently are at a higher income level, so that's not who it's going to affect. It's going to affect the people who can't afford to buy this insurance, and as a result, by paying that, you're going to get them out of the Child Health Plus program and have 80% of their private insurance paid for by the federal government.
And would this apply to the Army, the Air National Guard, the National Guard? They're not full-time in the military there.
They are part-time in, and it's only for these individuals who do not have other health insurance.
That was the next question I had. Thank you.
Okay, any other questions?
Mm-hmm.
Okay, second?
Second.
All in favor of this bill?
Aye.
Opposed? Okay, bill is reported to finance. Next bill is 2423. Council will read.
An act to amend the executive law in relation to state contract preference for service-disabled veteran-owned small businesses. This bill would amend the executive law to establish a program to provide a state contract preference for service-disabled-owned small businesses. It is mirrored off a very highly successful federal program, which establishes a 3% contract preference for such service-disabled veteran businesses for federal contracting purposes. This would mirror that and put it within state law.
Same concept of disability, the 40% that we're using for the property tax exemption?
The federal government establishes what constitutes a service-disabled veteran, and that is established by regulation. And no, it's a much more complicated than the 40% that is in Senator Goldman's bill.
So who would then determine that they're eligible?
It's pursuant to the federal government regulations.
Federal regs.
Any other questions? Motion to report.
Move it.
Second. All in favor?
Aye.
Opposed? And last bill, 2424, Council Reading.
This is an act to amend the executive law in relation to the establishment of the New York State Veterans Cemetery Act. This bill would amend and ask for the New York State's Division of Veterans Affairs to conduct an investigation and a study on the issue of establishment of a New York State Veterans Cemetery. Such an investigation and study would have to be compiled before December 31st, 2012. Presently, there are federal veterans cemeteries in New York State, but we're the only state in the union that does not have a state veterans cemetery. This bill would look to, for ways to resolve that issue. The federal government will pay 100% of the cost of construction. This will examine the issues on how you pay for maintenance and operations of such cemeteries.
As long as they build it in Staten Island.
Any questions?
Move it, Bill.
Very good. Okay. All in favor?
Aye.
Opposed? Bill's reported to finance. turn in your sheets. Thank you very much. Please meet individually on these issues, and I look forward to working. Thank you.